The Jesus, there's only one, is the center of my life. He's the center of this church. Jesus be the center of it all. Jesus be the center of it all. Y'all can sing it. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Y'all believe that? Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing in this world will do. Y'all sound so good. Jesus, be the center. Everything revolves around you. Jesus be the center of my life. Jesus be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing. Center of this church, and he is. Jesus be the center of this church, and every knee will bow, and every tongue confess that you are Jesus.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Come on, you can do better than that. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Just take a moment and just go ahead and just continue to thank Him and just worship Him right where you're at. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You are the center of it all. We just worship your name right now. You are the one and mighty God. Hosanna in the highest. Holy Spirit, we welcome you into this place. You are free to move up and down every aisle, in and out every road, touch, heal, deliver, set free, and make whole. If there's anything wrong in our lives tonight, we thank you that you're making it right. We thank you for all that you're going to do, all that you're going to say, for the revelation that you're going to bring forth. Father, I thank you for another opportunity to minister to these, your precious sheep. And I thank you that this revelation knowledge will flow freely. And it'll be uninterrupted and unhindered by any satanic or demonic force. I thank you that you are thinking through my vocal cords and thinking through my mind. And it'll be none of me and all of you. So tonight, may our ears be fully attentive to all you would have to say. And we just allow your peace right now just to rule in our hearts. And we lay every weight, every burden from the day aside. We take comfort and pleasure in knowing that you are here speaking to us in Jesus' name. If you agree with that, say amen. Amen. Come on, give God another hand clap of praise. Amen. Why don't you greet somebody who's near you? Tell them that you're glad that they made it. And then you can be seated. I'd like to also welcome our folks who are viewing online and our folks over at our South Community Group campus. I'd like to welcome all of you guys with us on tonight. How many of you guys are excited about the Word? I'm always excited about the Word, man. You guys sound like you like the Word. You didn't sound excited about the Word. I said, how many of you guys are excited about the Word of God? You know, it's the Word that gives us the instructions. I mean, Jesus could have just, you know, left us hanging, but God fortunately didn't do that. Instead, he gave us instructions that we can live by and follow. And it reveals so much to us for our everyday lives. And the Word is always rich, amen? I mean, you can keep going to it and see something new every single time, and that's the good news about Revelation. And here we've been talking about the Holy Spirit. We kind of said this was the year of the Holy Spirit, where we realized that it was going to take 100% relationship with Him in order to achieve the victory that God has already laid out for us all. So I think it was last week we began talking about having quality time with the Holy Spirit. And so we're gonna pick up there. And this is just part of a kind of a long series we've been on that I started a while back, called You Got It, Now Listen to the Holy Spirit and Go Get It. And what that simply means is, you know, so often we're trying to look for the blessing in our lives. So often we're looking for the manifestation of God's goodness and His grace. And according to grace, all that you need has already been made available. Amen? Whatever it is you need, salvation makes deliverance, it makes healing, it makes prosperity, it makes all that you need available. But we all know that we often live lives where we're trying to obtain what grace has made available. Now, we understand that it's by faith that I take what grace has made available. We taught that, you know, a few weeks back. When I believe and I have faith, I have confidence in God's and God's word, and then I follow the Holy Ghost so I can obtain, not create, so that I can obtain what God has already provided for me. Amen? But as we further explored that and got deeper into it, what we kind of discovered was that often people either don't have the right perspective of the Holy Spirit, or a better way to say it is a relationship with the Holy Spirit. And what you don't have a relationship with, you'll never receive from. You know what I mean? You know, I love my wife, and I have a relationship with my wife, a real relationship with my wife, a right relationship with my wife. So as a result, as she speaks to me, I can receive from her. But if I don't have a right relationship with her, I can say I love her. I'm technically married to her. But if I don't have a right relationship with her, one of honor, one of respect, one of covenant in that sense, then she can say what she wants to say, but I won't receive it. Amen. I would go as far to say that one who doesn't have a right relationship with the Holy Spirit may even find themselves as a believer, as a Christian, if you will, who goes to church and who hears the word but doesn't receive revelation from the Holy Ghost. And so because I don't have that relationship with him and that right perspective with him, I end up living my life as a believer, going to church, giving tithes and offering, doing all the things I think I'm supposed to do according to the word of God, but never achieving the victory that he has for me. And I don't know about you, but I've said enough is enough. We won't have a church, and we won't continue to have a church in the World Changers Nation that does not see the manifestation of God's goodness in every area of their lives. And we've discovered that the key is not that I need to necessarily give more, not that I need to necessarily pray more, not that I need to necessarily go to church more, it's that I need to listen to the Holy Spirit more. Where is he telling me to go to church? What is he telling me to sow? How much time am I spending with him in my time of prayer? Because he is the one that's supposed to be the director of my life. And he will tell me where to go, when to go, and how to go, and what to say to discover and obtain all that God has made available. If you understand that, say amen. Amen. So we began to talk about different ways that God was speaking to man, and we talked about how God in the Old Testament spoke himself. He also spoke through the law, and then we talked about how when Jesus came to earth, how God spoke, obviously, specifically through Jesus. But then Jesus did something after the cross. Jesus changed physical location. Now, this isn't a trick question, but who can tell me where Jesus now is? Yeah, at the right hand of the Father. Now, is the right hand of the Father on earth? No trick questions. Is the right hand of the Father on earth? No. So if Jesus was on earth and he was the teacher, he was the one that people listened to, he was the one that people followed, but then he said several times between John 14 and John 16 that he was going to what? Leave. He said, I'm leaving. And he said, it's better for you that I do leave, because if I don't leave, I won't be able to send you the Comforter. As a matter of fact, let's just look at that real quick. Go to John chapter 16. Let me make sure I show you this, because that's an important foundational point. And again, we're talking about this relationship with the Holy Spirit so that we can properly enter into spending quality time with them. So John chapter 16, I think we're going to go to verse, I think it's like verse 4 or 5. John 16, yeah, we're going to start at 4. So it says, but these things I have told you that when the time shall come, you may remember that I told you of them. And these things I said unto you at the beginning because I was with you. Now, verse 5, it says, but now I go my way to him that sent me, and none of you ask me, whither goest thou? But because I said these things unto you, sorrow has filled your heart. So the disciples were literally sad because Jesus is saying, I am leaving. Now, again, I'm not trying to mess with your theology. I'm not trying to hurt your feelings. We just have to have proper perspective on the role of the Holy Spirit right now. Because so often I've heard people say, Jesus, 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 and I'm like, well, kind of, sort of, but really Jesus did his responsibility while he was on earth. Now he has a new role that he's playing up in heaven as our advocate, as the one speaking on our behalf to the Father. His blood is still working. The grace is still working. But when it comes to getting things done on earth, it's not Jesus who is doing it. Because Jesus said, I have to go. Verse 7, it says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is expedient for you that I what? That I what? Yeah, that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come to you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you. Now let's look at this in the Amplified real quick. Go to we can just do verse 7 in the Amplified. So here's very clearly saying, he's saying, I got to go. It said, however, I'm telling you nothing but the truth when I say it is profitable. Somebody say profitable. Profitable. He's saying it's actually good or it's advantageous. It's better for you that I go. You know, this had to be blowing the disciples' mind. What do you mean it's better for you or for us if you, Jesus, God in the flesh, are no longer present with us? He said, it's better for you that I go. Because when I go, I can send you the Comforter. I can send you your counselor, your helper, your advocate, your intercessor, your strengthener, your standby. He is not going to be able to come to you or come into close fellowship with you unless I go away. And then he was trying to help him feel comfortable. He said, I'm going to be the one who sends him. He's not going to be a stranger that you don't know. He's not going to be somebody who's not highly recommended, but I am sending the Holy Spirit to you. Amen? The Holy Spirit's not going to pull up, you know, in front of your house like an Uber driver that you never met before, and you just got a, you know, like a cold call. You're just like, well, I guess I'm not going to talk to this guy because I don't know who this is. No, he said, this is going to be somebody you're going to be familiar with, somebody you're going to know. He's going to be your comforter, your counselor, your helper, your advocate, your intercessor, your strengthener, your standby. He's saying, because once I finish what I'm supposed to do, making grace available to you guys, making salvation available to you guys, once I finish making you the righteousness of God, my role has now been completed on earth for now. But you will still be here. And as a Christian, as a believer, you're going to need some comfort. You're going to need some help. You're going to need some counseling. Glory to the Lord. Anybody ever needed some counseling before? Amen. Now, we ain't saying you crazy, but sometimes we need somebody to talk to help us work some things out. You're going to need an advocate, somebody to step in and step up and speak on your behalf. Amen? You think you got to deal with that situation. You think you got to correct that person who was talking crazy to you. You think you got to go prove something to the boss when they lied on you. No. You think you got to say something to your spouse to check them because they think they're going to get away with talking to you like that. No. You don't have to worry about that. You have an advocate. His name is the Holy Ghost. Won't nobody pray for me? The Holy Spirit is your intercessor. I ain't got no friends, and I'm just going through this, and I wish I had somebody to pray for me. God Almighty, the Holy Ghost, is your intercessor. When you're weak, he's your strengthener. And then when you got to get things done, he is your power. He is your standby. So Jesus was saying, when I got to go and I can't be this for all y'all. Did you hear what I said? He was like, I can't be this for all y'all because I am God in the flesh, but I am in a physical body. Jesus was not omnipresent. What that means is Jesus couldn't be everywhere at one time. That body would not allow him to be this for all of us. Jesus could only be effective and powerful in those that he was around at that moment. When Jesus was preaching on the sermon or doing a sermon on the mount or whatever like that, if you was around the mount, you got blessed. If you weren't, you didn't. His ministry was limited because of the body that he lived in. But the Holy Ghost, who is God, is planted on the inside of each in every believer. So Jesus himself could not hang out and try to fulfill the role of helper. It was going to not work. I mean, only one of us would have been successful. Or only those who could be close or around him. But the Holy Ghost God understood in his plan that in his new covenant of grace, I'm going to now, as he said, pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Amen? And let's go to verse 8 real quick. It said, and when he comes, he'll convict and convince the world and bring demonstration to it about sin and about righteousness and about judgment. He'll convict and convince the world about and bring demonstration to it about sin, about righteousness, about judgment. Now, we've talked about this before, about sin. Is he talking about he's going to make you feel bad so that you'll want to change when you do wrong? Is that the job of the Holy Spirit? But how many of you guys have been taught that before in church? That the Holy Spirit is the one that's going to check you. And basically what we're saying is make you feel guilty whenever you do wrong, so somehow guilt is going to make you want to do right. But that's not what it's saying there. It says, and when he comes, he'll convict or he'll convince the world and bring demonstration to it about sin. Skip to verse 9 because it'll break down what that means. It says about sin, so he's being very specific, because they do not what? Believe in me. He's going to convince you that the problem with sin is a lack of belief in him. He's going to convince you that unbelief is the reason why there may be a sin problem in your life. Another way of saying that is he's going to convince you that unbelief is the root of any sin that's happening in your life. You got a stealing problem? It's because you don't trust God to provide whatever you're stealing. Amen? In a marriage and you're looking at somebody else, it's because you don't trust God to heal and to fix that marriage. Any sin problem can be traced back to a lack of belief. Another way we say it is any sin action in my life is just a reaction to unbelief. When I am convinced, when I trust in, rely on, and adhere to God on every situation in my life, the last thing I do is go and try to take care of it myself. Sin is simply put trying to take care of stuff yourself. Amen? Don't trust God. I'm going to do this. I'm going to make this happen. So the Holy Spirit was sent to convince the world that the problem is unbelief. Your behavior is a result of, do you believe God? So if I'm going to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, as I have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, he will be constantly fellowshipping with me, helping me and reminding me to trust God. Trust God. Follow me. Get out the driver's seat. Don't worry about this, because when you're worrying about it, that fear is going to lead you to want to take over and do it your way. So trust God. That's what he's constantly saying. That's all the word says. That's all the word says, trust God. And so he'll be confirming what the word is saying. That's why it sounds just like the word, or he sounds just like the word. And he's saying that's what it is that he's here to do. And then let's go to verse 10, just so we can sew this up. He said about righteousness, because I go to my Father and you will see me no longer. And righteousness is uprightness of heart and then being in right standing with God. He's convincing and convicting you of the fact that you are all good with God because of the sacrifice of Jesus. Now that's huge right there. Because when I don't think I'm right with God, when I think God is mad at me, when I think God is in a bad mood with me, the last thing I'm going to believe is that his blessings are overflowing into my life. The last thing I'm going to believe is that I'm healed. Why? Because I suck, and therefore I do not qualify for the good things of God. Can I be real? Because that's how we feel when we're by ourselves. I suck. I'm just horrible. I'm stupid. I'm ugly. I'm fat. I'm blah, 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 blah. I got an eating problem. I got a whatever problem, and da, 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 da. And because I am not perfect, God just cannot be okay with me. And so we beat ourselves up mentally. And that blocks us from hearing the direction and the leading of the Holy Spirit. I'm still blessed. Grace has still got everything I need, but I won't benefit from it because the Holy Spirit's convincing is not getting through. So he continues to try. He continues to work on me. He continues to get, and he's going to win. Amen. He's going to constantly be working in you because he doesn't fail, because that's still God who is love. And he's going to help you understand that you are all good with God. God's not mad at you. God's not even in a bad mood with you. The only way God knows about those sins is if you start talking about them. And if you talk about them and think about them, you're eventually going to start acting them out again. Sin is no longer a problem in your life. Why? Because the blood of Jesus washed your sins. You think Jesus is going up on a cross every time you sin? His blood got to be shed again and again and again. Oh, no, my bad. You think, according to 1 John 1:9, that every time you sin, that somehow sprinkles new blood on everything that goes on in your life. No, no, no. His blood washed your sins, past, present, and future. Now, as I renew my mind in the Word of God, as we're sitting here and doing tonight, as I begin to listen and follow the Holy Spirit as a result of a relationship and fellowship with Him, something will be manifested in my life. Galatians 5 talks about it. It calls anything when the Holy Spirit has been planted into your life and into your heart, and as you fellowship with Him and allow who He is to take root in your life, something begins to grow. And Galatians 5 calls it the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit is love. And it has with it joy, peace, temperance, gentleness. All these good things begin to come out of the life of a believer who is being led by the Spirit. And that's what begins to change my behavior. It's Him working on the inside of me and me trusting Him. You see, all of a sudden, the pressure for me to try to be perfect and act perfect, you've been trying that all your life. How's that working out for you? But when I can trust Him and I can follow Him and I can receive His love, transformation begins to take place. Only by a relationship with Him, though. Guys, I'm telling you, I've been saved for, I forgot how many years now, 38 years or something like that I've been saved. And the deal is that I've tried it pretty much all the different ways as a young person, a young adult, and a teenager, and blah, 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 blah. And the only way my behavior changed was when I'm walking in my relationship with the Holy Ghost. When I'm listening to what He says, when He says, get in that word, and I'm getting that word, and He tells me where to go and tells me what to read, it begins to renew and change my mind. And then before you know it, the fruit of the Spirit is coming out, and the things I used to do, I ain't doing no more. Because now my life is a reflection of the fruit of the Spirit. My life is a sum total of my relationship with the Holy Ghost. As I am victorious, it's because of my victorious relationship with Him. If you understand that, say amen. Amen. So, none of that was in my notes. But as a foundational thing, we have to understand that as I am walking with Him, I will have success. Now, I'm about to say something to you that's really controversial, so I just want you to buckle up and just follow me with this. Amen. Jesus was the Word of God, and the Holy Spirit indeed is the voice of God. Go with me to John, I think it's John 1:1. Let's just look at this real quick. I think it's John 1:1 and then John 1:14, I think it says it there too. Because we have to be precise in our understanding of who the Holy Spirit is and what His role is if we're gonna have proper fellowship with Him, amen? I can't kinda know my wife and who she is and think I'm gonna have a successful relationship with her, right? Okay, for those of you guys who are married, just so you know, you can't kinda know your woman, men, and think you're gonna have a successful relationship with her. My wife's not a really big seafood fan. So how many guys know if on her birthday I take her to a seafood restaurant because I kind of know what she like? How many guys know that's not going to result in good relations? I don't know no other way to make it plain to you. I'm trying to, y'all just look at me like, what are you talking about? So I need to know her for real if I want to have a successful relationship. So we got to be precise in what is the Holy Spirit's role, because many believers kind of know about him. You see what I'm saying? We kind of know, but do you really know what grieves the Holy Ghost? Do you really know how does he relate to the Word of God? Do you know those things? Because if you don't know, you can find yourself not fully being able to benefit from a relationship with him. And I forgot how the saying goes, but it's something like when you don't know the purpose of a thing, you abuse it. And when you don't know the purpose of the Holy Spirit and you don't know the role that he plays in everything that relates to this word, you'll find yourself in Holy Spirit abuse or grieving the Holy Ghost. You know what? But let me just give you that what it is, and then we'll teach it in the series here. But the Holy Spirit is grieved when he doesn't see the manifestation of grace in your life. That's what grieves him. He was sent to tell you you're the righteousness of God. He was sent to tell you sin is not the problem. He was sent to tell you that the devil is the one who's been defeated. And when he does not see the manifestation of grace in your life, when he sees you depressed, when he sees you downtrodden, when he sees you beat up, he is not happy with that. It's not about him being grieved because you made a mistake. He's grieved because the Holy Spirit is a part of the Trinity. And that means that the Holy Spirit is indeed God. And it makes him upset. It saddens him when he sees your life going in a direction that is not in line with God's word as far as you being blessed. If you understand that, say amen. John 1:1 says, in the beginning, before all time was the word, and then it put in parentheses, Christ, the anointed one in his anointing. And the word was with God, and the word was God himself. You see that right there, right? Black and white. Now go down to verse 14. In some Bibles, it has a little subtitle, and it says the Word. In the New American Standard Bible, it says the Word made flesh. Verse 14 says, and the Word Christ became flesh. He became a human. He became incarnate and tabernacled, fixed his tent of flesh, lived a while amongst us. So that word tabernacle, he kind of housed himself. The word took on a flesh suit. And he lived amongst us. And we actually saw his glory, his honor, his majesty, such glory as an only begotten son receives from his father, full of grace. The word is full of grace and of truth. So Jesus indeed is and was the word. I think we can also say often this, grace and truth is also the word too. Amen? So the word is very important. But how does the Holy Spirit relate to the word of God? I don't know if you ever thought about that, but that's an important thing because I've just taken it for granted that, you know, well, they just relate to each other. You know what I'm saying? God is the Holy Spirit is God, so they just all connected and it's all the same thing. But if you're not careful and look at the scriptures, you'll overlook something very important as it relates to the word of God and how the Holy Spirit uses the word and therefore how we should be using the word. Go with me to Ephesians 6, and let's start at verse 15. It's very important. Because if I'm going to be able to spend quality time with the Holy Ghost, if I'm going to be able to fellowship with him, the word is going to be in there, but I got to know how. Ephesians 6. Let's look at this in the easy-to-read version. You with me? Amen. Here we go. It says, that is why you need to get God's full armor. Then on the day of evil, you will be able to stand, what does it say? Strong. And when you have finished the whole fight, you will still be standing. Verse 14. So stand strong with the belt of truth around your waist, and on your chest wear the protection of right living. Verse 15. On your feet wear the good news. What's the good news? It's the gospel. What's the gospel? The gospel of grace. That's why it says good news in capital. Good news of peace to help you stand strong. I can stand strong in grace because I know I am favored by God. Grace is not about my behavior. Grace is not about my performance. It's simply about how good God is. Grace says that I don't get what I deserve. I get what he wants to give me, which is love, and that never fails. So that gives me peace. And I stand strong in that. I don't waver in that. I don't find myself fainting and falling out on anything because I got God's grace. I got his favor, unmerited, unearned, never ending. His favor is in my life. So that gives me peace. Peace is wholeness. It's soundness. It's nothing missing, lacking, or broken. That's a weapon. That's a tool. That's a piece of armor to help you fight this battle that you live every day in the world as a believer. I got peace. Say that with me. Say, I got peace. Verse 16. It says, and also use the shield of faith with which you can stop all the burning arrows that come from the evil one. Verse 17. Accept God's salvation as your helmet and take the sword of who?
The Spirit.
The Spirit. That sword is the teaching of God. Now, I've read this a million times, but I've never looked at the fact that it said, and take the sword, and it didn't have a period right there, did it? Whose sword is it? Sword of the Spirit. Let's look at this in the King James Version, verse 17. And then we'll look at it in the Amplified after that. It says, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now go to the Amplified. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword that the Spirit wields, which is the word of God. Now that kind of puts a picture in my mind. The Holy Spirit is a person, right? He's real, right? And this gives you the image that he is the one taking the word of God and going to work. Here I am the whole time thinking that I'm just going to confess what I think I should be confessing, and that is going to work. No, I'm here to tell you, believer, I'm here to tell you, child of God, that if the Holy Spirit is not leading your confession, then you have now taken over his job. You could be sitting confessing the word of God and just be as ineffective as a rock in trying to paint a wall. That's all that came to my head. I'm sorry. But you know what I mean? Because remember, even the devil was quoting a word to Jesus in Matthew chapter 4. So don't get it twisted. It's not about me just knowing a bunch of scriptures. The devil knows the word of God. But when he wields the word, it's of no effect. I told you, you gotta stay with me. Now, I'm just showing you what's in the word. So it is that a human being can sit up here and try to wield the word minus the Holy Ghost and be totally in the flesh. But if I have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, he will lead me and show me and give me revelation off this word and confession and action that is birthed out of the relationship with the Holy Spirit that coincides with the word. That's the Spirit wielding the sword. It's his sword. Say that with me. It's his sword. And there's nowhere in the word that says he stops using it and just gives it to us to use as we please. And do you realize this is actually the only offensive weapon that's listed in the armor? It didn't say nothing about a spear. It didn't say you got some arrows. It says you got a sword to go and start chopping stuff up with. And it's not even your responsibility to wield it. It's not your responsibility to wield the sword. It's your responsibility to yield to the Holy Spirit. That's your job, is to believe. There we go back to John 16, to trust, to rely, and to depend on the Holy Ghost. And then he will tell you what to say. He will tell you what to do. He will tell you how to live based on this word. Again, we come out of the driver's seat. And it is 100% have your way. Ooh, that's tough for some Christians. That's tough for some believers. But I tell you what, it is indeed the way to success for every believer. If you understand that, say amen. I wrote this down. I said, if we replace the Spirit's presence in the Bible, if we replace the Spirit's presence with the Bible, we no longer have the sword of the Spirit. We have a human sword. As we will seek to use the word of God through the wisdom of man. The wisdom of man will not be enough to understand and apply the real truth that the Bible contains. What am I saying? You won't have any revelation. You will be able to understand this as far as your knowledge goes, as far as your education ability goes. And for some of us, that may not be a good idea. Amen. You get them dusts and dials and those, and you're like, whoa, that's about it for me. That's how I was. But man, the moment I began to have a relationship with the Holy Spirit, then all this stuff started making sense. Amen. So Holy Spirit, help me say it. We have to humble ourselves. Amen. It might be that you ain't got no giving problem. It might be that you ain't got no heart problem at the end of the day. It just might be that you just got a humility problem. You just might need to just think a little less of yourself. Amen? And that could be the revelation. That could be the thing to turn everything around for you. Just to say, I don't know. But he does. Because I will not have a relationship with the Holy Spirit if there's no motivation to. That's why some people don't have a Holy Ghost experience. We call it a come to Jesus experience, but many of us don't have a Holy Ghost experience until a crisis happens. Once a crisis happens, then it proves to us you don't know. Amen? Somebody hits rock bottom and then they're like, God, help me. And then the Holy Spirit is, I've been trying to talk to you. And then we hear him and we listen. But don't let crisis be the creator of revelation in your life. The Holy Spirit wants to love on you in peacetime. And then you'll be at peace in wartime. Because he'll be yielding that sword. Wielding that sword as you're yielded to him. So this is who he is. He's the voice of God. He's a real person. And he's on your behalf working in you. He's also on your behalf working out in the world for you as your advocate, your intercessor, your counselor, your power. He is all of that. And we haven't even been able to get to yet what happens when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Remember, we're just talking about the Holy Ghost living in you and what he does. But for you to understand what the Holy Ghost does when he gets on you, you got to go look at Samson. You got to go look at all those guys and those cats from the Old Testament. And when he got on people, that's when the physical power of God would manifest for the will of God to get done. How many of you guys know he's not stopping that? That's not over. But because there's an absence of belief and trusting and relationship with the Holy Spirit, we see it less and less and less in the body of Christ. Remember one time I was at my table and, you know, I was like, Musa, look, I'm gonna make this glass move. And I was like, I'm trying to wield the power of God. So I was playing, but trying to act like, you know, I can make this thing move. I watched one too many sci-fi movies. But I was like, yo, but God, for real, you have like real power. And I believe in that real power. I believe in what I've seen in the Bible and about these miraculous things taking place and the strength that people had. And I forgot who it was, one of the prophets being able to run and outrun a chariot and all this stuff. Like, Lord, I believe in that. I think it was Elijah. That's who it was, who outran the chariot. I don't know if you saw this last Avengers movie, but I ain't going to spoil it for you if you didn't see it, but there's a part where Captain America and Black Panther are running, and they're running at the bad guys. And they literally start taking off and they outrun everybody. And first of all, I was like, yo, Captain America can run. I mean, we kind of expected Black Panther to be able to do it, but you know, but Captain America, I was like, look at him. But it reminded me of Elijah being able to outrun that chariot. It was something supernatural when the Holy Ghost got on him. And I was sitting there playing around, and the Holy Spirit told me clear as day, he said, you'll never experience my power until you're in a place that it's needed. And I was like, yo, first of all, I'm going to stop playing. But second of all, if you're not out there doing outreach, if you're not out there in the mission field, if you're not out there winning souls, then don't expect to see the power of God manifest in your life, because it's not for you, it's for them. Amen. That's why it's no coincidence that you go to third world countries or go to other places around the world and they see often greater moves of God, because you have people actually depending on God to win souls and to change lives in other people. But in America, we've gotten a little lazy in the fact that we come together and we preach to each other. How many saved folk in the room tonight? Raise your hand if you're saved. Real, just raise your hand if you're saved. Not embarrassing, not to be ashamed. There's not a person in the room whose hand is not up. So if your hand is up and you are saved, then that means you have the power of God already operating in your life. Amen? Now, it doesn't mean that God still won't move on your behalf or do certain things, but, oh, Jesus, let me be careful, but I just got to say it the way it is. You got the power. There's nothing I can offer you, oops, that you don't already have. So to expect to see something mighty and miraculous and woo happen, there'll be revelation that'll come from this word, because this word that we're teaching tonight will help us understand grace and be empowered to change. You'll understand how to have a better relationship with the Holy Spirit, and as a result of a better relationship with him, you will be able to hear his voice and follow his voice, and we haven't got to this yet, but his voice is going to tell you, go out there and do something on my behalf. By the way, that's where we're going with this series. We're just leading up to the point to where we're going to hit the gifts of the Spirit and all of that, and then we're going to learn, oh, these gifts is for them out there. Not for me to be able to say I'm this prophetess. Not for me to be able to say I prayed for people and they got healed. No, the gifts are for the people who don't know him. They're a sign of his love. And if we come together and just keep preaching to one another, all we're doing is power talking to power. Is light shining on light? Where did power of God go in the church? It's powered out. It's just like everything's powered up. But bring an unbeliever through the doors. Watch what happens. Bring a prostitute through the door. Watch what happens. Bring a homeless man who ain't thinking quite right through the door. Watch what happens. Bring an unsaved, weed-smoking, crack-having killer through the door and watch what happens. I know, well, you don't want them. They might get off on me. Man, that's some weak Christianity you got. No, that's what we're supposed to be doing. We're supposed to be going out to the highways and byways and bringing them in. Acts 1 and 8 says, and you shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and then he gives you purpose so that you can go be witnesses. You got the power to be a witness. Not the power to make your life better. Your life, you got, that's why I started off by saying, you got everything you need. Do you trust that? The body of Christ has to mature. It has to grow up. This is the year, guys. We got to grow up, because we can't keep being stuck at I need more. Because you ain't going to never go help somebody else put their oxygen mask on if you still trying to get yours on. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. I can't breathe. The people died over there, and you just out there, just put the mask on and go help somebody. That's what Jesus was showing us to do. He said it in Mark. He said, you got to go preach this gospel, and then signs and wonders are going to follow. Where the signs and wonders? Where the preaching of the gospel to the people? Oh, y'all don't want to hear that today. Let me go on and get back on the outline. But Jesus had a relationship with the Holy Ghost. Jesus didn't do this by himself. It was 30 years of Jesus as the man on earth without a miracle, without a lesson. And don't get it twisted. It wasn't just that one day an alarm clock went off, ding, it's time to be anointed. No, there was an experience that Jesus went through that then empowered him to go to work on behalf of God. Go with me to Matthew 3. I don't know, this must be for somebody, because y'all know we covered this, but man, it's coming out a little differently tonight, and I like it. Amen. Matthew chapter 3, verse 16. You ought to know this one by heart by now. We'll look at this in the easy-to-read version. Matthew 3, 16. It says, so Jesus was what? Baptized. Now, here's the experience. Jesus came up to John, and he said, John, you got to baptize me? John was like, yo, no, I need to be baptized of you. And Jesus was like, listen, you know the prophecies. You know how it's supposed to go down. Suffer it to be so. And he was like, okay, I'm going to do it. So then Jesus was baptized, and as soon as he came up out of the water, the sky opened, and he, talking about John, notice that's singing out of capital H, so this wasn't Jesus, John saw God's Spirit come down, not as a dove, like a dove. So it looked like it had wings or something, I guess. And I guess it was kind of white because that's what the color of a dove is. But the Holy Spirit is not a bird, amen? But he came down like a dove. Now, who is God's Spirit? Not a trick, remember, no trick questions. Who is God's Spirit? All right, that means I'm doing all right with the teacher. Dr. Dollar, I'm so sorry. They don't know who the Holy Spirit is. He saw the Holy Spirit come down and rest on Jesus. One translation says, never to leave him. How many of you guys know the Holy Ghost ain't leaving you because you mess up? Verse 17. And then a voice from heaven said, who do you think this is? The voice from heaven. So this is God the Father. So here you have Jesus, God in the flesh, the Son, going to work on the earth. You have the Holy Ghost coming and resting on him. And then you have the Father speaking. And the Father said, this is my Son. One translation says, my beloved Son. The one that I love, I am very please with him. When did Jesus get his identity? He got his identity on earth when the Holy Ghost came upon him. He didn't go to work. You can't go to work if you ain't got no job description, if you ain't got no job title, and you ain't got no job description. And if you ain't got no job title and no job description, you can't go to work. You're just gonna sit there and say, well, y'all gonna, somebody gonna tell me what to do? Well, you ain't got no role. Jesus' role wasn't identified. He couldn't walk in the power of God. He couldn't be the Christ without the Holy Ghost. And we can't be Christians or believers without the Holy Spirit. We have an assignment. We have a purpose. We have a job description. And it comes with and includes 100% the almighty power of God. So without him, it's almost like I'm just a shell of a believer. I'm a form of a believer. And you kind of see that sometimes. When people are operating without the Holy Ghost, it just seems like their life is fruitless. I don't know about you, but I'm not living a fruitless life. I don't know about you, but I want everything that the Holy Ghost can lead me to. And I'm greedy for the Holy Ghost and the manifestation of him in my life. Amen? And this is why this was so important, because go to chapter 4 real quick, 4:1. Now, Jesus has his identity. He has his purpose. And then he begins to follow the teacher in his life, the instructor in his life. It says, then the Spirit, read this with me. Then the Spirit led Jesus into the desert. He was taken there to be tempted by the devil. What? Wait a minute, I thought the Holy Spirit was supposed to be loving. You mean he took Jesus into temptation? I mean, he took Jesus into a place where he would be tempted? Why would he do that? He had to teach him. See, the Holy Spirit knows the courses that you need to take in life to graduate and to operate as you're created to on this world. I hope you wrote that down or watch it on YouTube later. But he's the one that knows what you need to go through and what you need to overcome in order to be successful in operating as a believer on this world. That's why you got to follow him. Many of us would have avoided. Are you crazy? I just got saved. And you telling me to go back into that bar? The Holy Spirit understood that you're going to need to be able to trust me, Jesus, because you got a cross to go to. See, it wasn't about Jesus learning how to trust the Holy Ghost so he can preach to people, or Jesus learning how to trust the Holy Ghost so he can heal people. It was about that night when he was going to be in that garden. When he said, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. That was because he understood, I am a son. I am the son of God. And I got a job to do. Well, how can you say that was the issue? Yeah, that's what the devil was trying to test him on. He was trying to test his identity, tempt him to think he wasn't the son of God. Don't believe me? Let's look at the next verse, verse 2. He went in there to be tempted by the devil. Jesus was on a fast. He was hungry. He hadn't eaten for 40 days. Some of us, if we don't eat for 40 minutes, we messed up. And he hadn't eaten for 40 days and nights. And it said after this, he was very hungry. Verse 3. It said the devil came to tempt him, and here's how he tempted him. If you are the Son of God. What did God just say to him in verse 17 in chapter 3? This is my beloved son. The temptation was his identity, his sonship. The thing he had just, quote unquote, got. The devil was already messing with him, trying to tempt him to think he wasn't what he was. And then he goes on through all of this, trying to get Jesus to perform, to do something, to prove who he was. When you know who you are, you ain't got nothing to prove. And you don't do nothing that the Holy Spirit don't tell you to do. And as you continue to read this, all Jesus kept doing was speaking the word of God. As the Holy Spirit was leading him, he was speaking. He was speaking. And with the power of God on his life, he whooped the devil that day. Go to verse 11. It says, so the devil left him. Then some angels came to Jesus and helped him. Verse 12. Jesus heard that John, that's the end of that. So, and that's what it says. And the devil left him once he kept confessing the word. And later on in that chapter, it says Jesus then left the wilderness full of the power of the Spirit. He was charged up and ready to go. And the rest was history. But he had relationship and fellowship with the Holy Ghost to such a point that he followed him into the wilderness. Are you willing to follow the Holy Spirit wherever he leads you? Are you willing to trust him no matter how dark it may look? Because wherever he takes you, he will equip and provide for you all that you need to be successful. Amen. Jesus had a word, and he had the word, and he was ready for anything that the devil came at him with. He kept saying, but the word says, the word says, the word says. And that's what you're going to say when the devil tries to tempt you with stuff. You're going to say, but the word says I'm healed. But the word says I'm whole. But by his stripes I'm healed. I got peace that passes all understanding that guides my heart and mind. I'm rich because he supplies all my needs according to his riches and glory. All is well with me because that's God's promises. But I only know that as I fellowship with the Holy Spirit. So really the thing you got to choose today is that you're going to trust God. You're going to trust the Holy Ghost. You're not going to look to the right or to the left. You're not going to worry about what other people are doing or saying, but you're just going to say, Holy Spirit, have your way. Have your way in my life. I believe you. I trust you. I'm going to follow you. And as you do that, you will constantly run into the manifestation of God's grace along the way. God has provided all that you need. I want you to see your life like a path. And on that path is every bit of goodness, every bit of grace, every bit of money, every bit of peace, every bit of good relationship that you need. It's on the path that God has set up for your life. And the Holy Spirit will lead you in that path for what? For righteousness' sake. It's His path. But it's on that path that you will have provision. Abraham, when he went up on the mountain that God led him to, found the ram. That ram wasn't on the other mountain. That ram wasn't on a mountain that Sarah may have thought about, or that Isaac may have thought about, or that Abraham may have thought, I think that's a better mountain, that's a taller mountain, let's go to that mountain to sacrifice. No, God said, I'm going to send you to the mountain that I want you to go to. And they started walking without even knowing what mountain, because they trusted God. And then they got to the mountain, and that's the mountain the angel showed up on. What if they would have went to another mountain? The angel would have showed up where? On the right mountain, and they would have been somewhere else, and that man would have killed his son. How you know? Because the ram was on the other mountain. There was going to be a sacrifice that day. And my God, if Abraham would have chose to not trust God and go to another mountain, he wouldn't have found the ram. And if he didn't find the ram, then the lamb would not have been made available to all of us. Because that was representative of Jesus saying, because you were willing to give your son, I am now symbolically going to provide my own sacrifice. And what that was a shadow of and a representation of was that God was saying, I am going to provide Jesus, the lamb, as my sacrifice. Man will not have to sacrifice another thing. I'm going to provide my own sacrifice. Thank God, Abraham trusted and relied and depended on him. So that is the secret, guys. I got all this other stuff, and we'll talk about it next week. I got all this other stuff about entering into your secret place and in the bedchamber and when you're praying and everything like that. But we got to make sure that we're trusting the Holy Ghost. Because as I trust him, my goodness, I'll be running to fellowship with him. And as I fellowship with him, there's nothing but goodness. Nothing but victory, nothing but grace in every area of my life. So just right now, just raise your hands and just make a quality decision right now that you're going to submit every area of your life under the guidance of the Holy Ghost, that He's going to be your umpire. An umpire is one that makes decisions and calls shots. They're the ones who kind of say what's in and what's out, what's safe. Decide that you're going to let him tell you what's safe in your life. Decide that you're going to let him tell you what's out of bounds. Decide that you're going to follow him. And make that commitment right now. And say, oh, you know, just Holy Spirit, have your way in all of my life. Have your way in my financial decisions. Have your way in my relationships. Have your way in my thinking. Have your way on my job. Have your way in my classes if you're in school. Have your way in my serving. Have your way. No longer will we do what we want to do, Holy Spirit, but we're ready to grow up and to be led by you. We receive your love. We receive your direction. We're excited about the fact that you love us, and therefore, as we hear and follow you, there will be no failure in our lives. I come against any health failure. I come against any financial failure. I come against any relational failure. I come against any employment failure. I come against any mental failure, and we release success in this place right now. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we believe it. Jesus, we thank you for making a way for it. And Holy Spirit, we got it. In Jesus' name. If you agree with that, say amen. Come on and give God a hand clap of praise. Did you get anything out of that tonight? Amen. I hope you did, man. I enjoyed saying it. And I want you just to make now a quality decision that you're gonna trust God. And you're not turning back. Amen. So tonight's a new night. Today's a new day. And I'm excited to see all the manifestation of grace that's going to take place in your life. Amen? Amen. Let's give God a hand clap of praise one more time. Well, now it's time to just trust God in your giving. You know, I told you, I've made up my mind. I don't have to wait to church to hear the Holy Spirit to tell me what to give. I'm like, talk to me when I get up. Tell me what to give today, Lord. He tells me, I do it. Amen. He tells me to do more, I'll do more. But be led by the Spirit even in your giving. Trust God in every part of your life. So if you want to give on tonight, sowing, tithes, offering somebody, should I do my tithes? Do what the Lord tells you to do. Ain't nothing wrong with paying tithes. But you're not going to hell if you don't. Amen. Me paying my tithes, me doing an offering, that's a sign of me trusting whatever God told me to do. Amen. But it's not a law that I have to live under. Because if you're giving tithes and offering, yet you're giving it out of fear, you're worried about everything else that can go wrong in your life, if you sow that, guess what? You're just giving your money away. Somebody said, oh, did he just say that? I'm not afraid. God supplies all our needs. Amen? If your faith is not there, see, the widow, she gave the two mites. She gave everything she had, and her faith was there. Amen? She gave up out of proportion of what she had, and she believed, she trusted. But if you're giving and you don't believe and trust, you better go and just pay your rent. Amen? I love you, I'm gonna tell you the truth. But man, if you know how to trust God and you know how to believe him in that area and you've grown to that level and matured to that level of faith, you do exactly what the Holy Spirit tells you to do and let him prove how good he is. Because I'm telling you, it's nothing like needing more. You don't have enough in the first place. The Holy Spirit tells you to go ahead and sow what you got, and then you do it, and then you see God perform in your life. See, that's the other side of it. If you're able to trust him, if you're able to depend on him, if you're able to rely on him and do what he says, he will show up and show out nonstop in your life. And then it will become a testimony that you will be able to share with others, because remember, it's all about others. That you'll be able to share with others and tell them, listen, I only had $10. It was my last. And I was planning on saving that for some gas and this, that, and other, but the Holy Spirit told me to sow it, and I sowed it not out of guilt, not out of because the pastor made me feel bad if I didn't, not because it had a $5 and another $5 line. It was simply because he told me to do it, and I did it, and I'll be doggone before I left out of that place, somebody blessed me with $100. I've heard it over and over and over again. That's for people who are willing to trust them. So just make your mind up. But I trust God. Amen. We'll go ahead and hold those phones or offerings up in the air. Father, we just thank and praise you right now for the gifts that we're sowing. We do it out of faith. We do it out of trust. We do it out of belief in you. And as a result, we know that we're going to receive a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, shall men give back into our bosoms. And we thank you, Lord, for a hundredfold return on all the seeds that are being sown. And even if folks didn't have to give tonight, you said you'd give seed to the sower. That's a decision they've made to give. So they've given in their hearts, Lord, and so I thank you that you're increasing them so that they'll have seed for the future. And we give you all the glory and praise for that spiritual seed that they planted on tonight will result in a manifested harvest in the natural. We call it done. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, you may serve the people. As you're serving the folks, before we leave, we just want to give you an opportunity to receive prayer for what you may need. We already know everybody in the house is saved. We talked about that in the message. So if you know Jesus, but you have not received the baptism of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, that's what happened to Jesus in Matthew 3:16 when the Holy Spirit came up on him. If you have not received him and received that power up on you, there's nothing to be embarrassed or ashamed of. It is just something you want to get some understanding on and go ahead and be able to walk in it, because that is the other part of the experience of a believer. It's salvation, and then there's baptism of the Holy Ghost. Amen? And that's different from water baptism. Water baptism is just an outward expression of you being saved. Amen. You're just saying, I'm saved, I'm God's. And so when I go down in this water and I go down dirty, I come up clean. And it's symbolic. But the baptism of the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God coming up on you to equip you for operation in his kingdom. Don't leave out of this place without all your equipment. Amen. And last but not least, if you don't have a good church home, I tell you what, I say this is the best church in Texas all the time. And the reason why I say that is simply because if this is where God called you to, it is the best place for you. There is no better place than the place God calls you to. But y'all don't have all the lights that they got over here, and y'all don't have all of this. But I tell you what, we got exactly what you need if God has called you here. Amen? So you decide. If you want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or if you want to join a church, if that's you, come down here to the front. So I'm going to ask everybody to stand to your feet and minister to those who are around you. Ask them if they need prayer for any of those two things. If they say yes, then help them come down to the front. If they're all good, just give them a high five and a hug, and we'll get you out of here. Amen.
How he loves us.
Amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise for that. Before we go, real quick, I'm going to throw this scripture at you. Y'all like, your preaching time is done. Let me just say this real quick. James 4, chapter 7 through 8, it says, submit yourselves to God first, then resist the devil, and then it said, he'll flee. Then it says God will draw near to us. Melissa was sharing that with me. And that's so true. It's what we're talking about. As I submit myself to the Holy Spirit, submit myself to his will, then the devil has to flee. That's what happened with Jesus in Matthew 4. He submitted his will to God, spoke the word, and then the devil had to flee. And then, yeah, God can draw near because the Holy Spirit's right there. And it's not talking about like he ran away from you. It's that you can hear his voice clearer. That voice gets nearer to you. And as it's nearer, the closer I get to you, the better you can hear me. And so it all starts with submission. So take a look at your life this week. And just decide in everything, I'm submitting to the will of God. Married couples, remember that the will of God will be spoken through your spouse. Amen. He or she is the rest of you. And then the third person in your covenant is the Holy Ghost. So just listen and submit. Single folks, it's you and the Holy Ghost. You got it even easier. Amen. Amen. So you just listen and submit. And get closer to God and watch the goodness just overtake your life. Amen? Let's raise our hands and be prepared to be dismissed. Now unto him who can keep you and present you faultless before the Almighty God, to him be glory, majesty, dominion, and power. Father, as we leave this place today, we go submit it to you. We go in your grace. And we'll be careful to give you all the glory, honor, and praise for the victory that we experience as we apply this word in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We love you guys so much. You are dismissed.